Fatboy Slim. Is it more polite to say Mr. Norman Cook?
My friends call me Norman.
Okay. Did I call you Norman?
I'm not sure what that means for us.
That's what I call me Norman.
They can call you Norman?
Yeah.
I feel like it's just because Norman Cook's not a DJ, right?
No, Norman Cook is the sort of quiet, respectable father of two.
Yeah.
And Fatboy Slim's this sort of irresponsible party hedonist lunatic. It's important to keep the two separate.
And do your kids know that the two are the same, or is it like a Batman Bruce Wayne situation?
Their kids, hopefully the kids only see the sensible side.
Yeah. Right.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Now you're playing huge shows all around the country, but you're kicking off in Melbourne. A little club down the road, a place called Revolver, where most people end up at. You're starting there. What's it like playing those intimate venues versus the huge ones? What do you like about them?
Oh, it's just beautiful. For me, I mean, that's how I started DJing in clubs. And it's great doing the big shows, but they're quite hard work. I have to really concentrate. Whereas when I'm in a club, I can just let it loose. I can try out new song tunes. And so for me, that's my reward. We're doing the big shows, they let me play at Revolver.
They let you?
Yeah. Well, I beg. I beg.
I'm sure they'll have you without you doing the big shows. Yeah. I mean, if you just said, can I please come
It's a long way to come just for that one, one show, but I'll think about it.
If I know anything about the nightclub Revolver, it's that they'll have anyone. So you'll be welcome there.
And you say it's a long way to come for one gig, but the gig will go for 4 days.
Yeah. So.
Now, you talk about the differences between the small shows and the big shows. One big one that, you know, is quite famous was the Brighton Beach Party in 2012. Yeah. They're making a documentary about it. This is insane. What do you remember about that day? That's just...
It's a huge mixture of elation and fear, because that's my hometown, and to have that many people very elated, but at the same time, like, we couldn't deal with... We ran out of toilets. The whole city ran out of alcohol. Because there was just too many people. Seriously, they drunk every single off-licence bottle shop
dry. Was there a mutiny?
And, so it was... And we were on the edge of disaster. And if you watch the documentary, you can see how close... I mean, literally, we were only allowed to do it because it was more dangerous not to do it. Because people would have been drinking on the beach all day, and if we didn't do the show, it really would have kicked off. But, yeah, the documentary is quite... It's sort of kind of... Yeah, it's the highs and the lows of it. And it's like the Fyre Festival or the Woodstock one, but without the real horror.
Yes.
Just the edge.
And also, unlike the Fyre Festival, that happened.
Yes.
So you're expecting 40,000, right? And 250,000 people to... I assume you'd never played to an audience like that. And like, how do you do it? Is in your mind, are you going, how do I reach the person like 3Ks that way?
I don't know. I always just play to the people I can see. You can't play to people you can't see. And, you know, after a certain amount, you can't see it. I mean, I was trying to contain my nerves, excitement, like trying to keep it linear. Because, like you said, that's my home city.
Yeah.
And to do that in your home city on the beach was like the pride, but also the pride and the fear.
But also big for the UK, right? So this is described as a pivotal moment in dance music and electronic music for the UK. Why was that?
Well, it was just kind of a coming together of all the tribes, you know, everybody who kind of liked that music all descended and, you know, so it's like an affirmation, like the original Woodstock was, of, you know, everybody took together. But it was kind of... There was just so many of them that we went near a disaster, so we've never been allowed to have a free show like that before nowadays. But they learned a lot about crowd control, and it was testament to my crowd that nothing badly went wrong because they were so kind of well-behaved.
Well, they ran out of alcohol.
In the end, that just...
So tell me about the ravers these days. They've obviously changed over the years. I mean, you've been doing this for a while. What have you noticed in terms of the people who come to your music?
Nothing.
And they're all the
Nothing
same?
At all. Well, the ones I can see down the front, they're all still 18 and they remain 18 every year, this like new 18-year-old. So there's a fresh influx, and I'm aware there's older ones down the back, and obviously I'm no spring chicken. But no, I mean, the basic thing of raving is it's for everybody to come together and commune, and but also escape from the problems of your life or a boring life or whatever, and it's a celebration of us together, and that, you know, the technology might change in how we do it, but the sort of primeval instinct of what we do, I don't think changes at all.
You mentioned technology. Rapper Drake had a song. Well, it's not his song. AI made a song that was made to sound like Drake. Are you, what does AI do with music in the future?
Well, it shouldn't try and copy me, because my songs are pretty stupid, and I don't think the AI's got the thing to like turn off the intelligence to make my, because my songs are like sort of deliberately stupid. So I don't know. I'm fairly Luddite about technology, and the AI thing is still kind of baffling me. Apart from all I know is that, like, visually we can stick my head on other people's bodies. That's about the limit of what we can do. But in terms, in terms of songwriting, who knows? I think. The basic thing about the arts, and especially music, is that human fallibility or that human stupidity. Yeah. And I think for artificial intelligence to try and artificially find our unintelligence and our faults is going to be impossible.
We know
and then that's the good bit. It's our mistakes that are so good. Yeah.
We know you've got a gig to get to, so we're going to let you go. But don't miss Fatboy Slim live all around the country. All the info's on our website.